Bluetooth connected.
For you and me, so come on, bring a friend, there's really
right, friends, while the kids are having a seat for a moment, we're going to have our morning announcements and share what's going on. So Cammie's going to come up and share our announcements with us.
So more VBS work nights are now posted in the narthex. We still need 50 egg cartons. So please donate those. Monday 6 to 8 for the work night. And Wednesday 6 to 8 for the work night. And then Lynn had an announcement.
Hi, I'd like to invite everyone to my piano recital. If you're not doing anything this Tuesday night at 6:30, my students will be giving a recital right here in the sanctuary. That's Tuesday night at 6:30.
Thank you. Are there any other announcements we need to highlight? All right, friends. So the main thing that's coming up is Vacation Bible School. If you can lend a hand, please sign up to help at Vacation Bible School. They're collecting egg cartons as you finish up a dozen eggs at home. Don't throw it away. Just bring it into the church kind of thing. If everyone would bring in one, obviously we'd have enough. So, and if you can lend a hand with these VBS work nights, they're making all the decorations. You can see they've already started to decorate the hallway, going out to the parking lot and things like that. It's an underwater theme. They took a lot of help to make those decorations. All right, friends, I'm going to invite you to stand, please, if you're able, as we begin our time of worshiping God together. Give someone a handshake or a hug and welcome them to the house of the Lord today. And friends, I invite you to remain standing if you're able. Please remain standing if you're able as you return to your places this morning. Today is Pentecost Sunday. It's the birthday of the church as we talk about receiving God's Holy Spirit and God's Spirit putting us into action in the world as the body of Christ. Our opening song this morning is If We Are the Body, because remember, we have to be the body of Christ for this world on Pentecost Sunday. We're going to begin worship by singing If We Are the Body.
Why is his love so damn there is a way?
Amen. Would you pray with me, please, friends? Lord our God, on this Pentecost Sunday, we just pray you fill this place with your Holy Spirit and each one of us to overflowing, Lord. Let us be the body of Christ. Let us go out into this world and share your love because we're so filled with it, so filled with your Spirit that we want to share it with others when we leave this place. We just pray this in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Friends, you may be seated. There's another piece of special music, some more members of Fusion. I think the entire group this time is going to come up. All eight, no? We made a change, I apologize. It's great. 2 through 8, it says. That's what you told me.
Okay. This is everybody then.
So the younger kids are done.
So while Miss Janelle is getting everybody set up, I'm just gonna tell you a little bit about the group for those of you that don't know them. This year our name was Fusion because we were fusing a bunch of different styles of music together. Not only are they singing, but the younger kids also learned ukuleles in the first half of the year. And the second half of the year, we experienced some things with some steel drums. If you've seen our steel drum group at the middle school, it's an extension of that. There was a little too many logistics for us to do all of that today. In addition, our older students, and I have to apologize to Firmly Grounded because they would probably come in and wonder why their music and their stands were everywhere after our rehearsals. We tried to put them back as best as we could, but the older kids had what we call a garage band. So they put together, if you've ever seen the 4-chord song on the internet, they put together a song, they chose all the songs, and everything is based on 4 chords, and we had our own little rock band up here. So we're not performing that or the steel drums today just because of logistics, but just wanted you to know some of the other things that the kids were doing besides singing. So I think we have the whole group up here, and they're gonna sing what, Mr. Noe? Canon of Hope. Thank you.
Amen. Well, if you younger kids would like to stay up here and have a seat, and the other younger kids from on the pews, if you'd like to come up and join us for the children's time, please, you're welcome to. Kids, you can have a seat, and the other kids, you can come up and join for the children's time, please. Everyone else can sit up here with me for a minute, and then we let you go out to Sunday school then, okay? Right, you got to be more enthusiastic than the adults. You ready? Good morning.
Good morning.
Excellent. Would you please raise your hand if it is your birthday today? Raise your hand if it is your birthday today. Do you know what? It is your birthday today.
Yeah.
You say it's your birthday. Da-na-na-na-na. It's my birthday too. It because exactly right, Micah, because today is the church's birthday and you are the church. So everybody raise your hand because today's your birthday. Raise your hand. It's your birthday, yeah, it's your birthday. It is the church's birthday today, which means today is the day, a couple thousand years ago, when God gave his Holy Spirit to the disciples, and they were filled with God's Spirit, and they went out and told everybody about Jesus and his love, and they changed the world, and the church was born. And ever since, we've been trying to spread God's love and tell everybody about Jesus and what he did and his love. And so we consider this the birthday of the church. So actually, Mr. Ken is at the piano and he's going to play Happy Birthday for us. And we're going to sing Happy Birthday, Dear Church. When we get to the part where it says dear, we're going to sing Dear Church, Happy Birthday to you. You ready? Okay, now how I always start, and I always say it to be more enthusiastic than the adults, and I say good morning. This time I'm going to say happy birthday, and you say happy birthday very enthusiastically. You ready? Happy birthday!
Happy birthday!
It is your birthday, and birthdays are something you celebrate, and we want to celebrate the church, because the church is the people in the world who are trying to spread God's love, and you are that. You are part of that, trying to share God's love, so you're the church, so it's your birthday. All right, we'll say a little prayer together. Dear God, thank you so much for your love. Thank you for pouring out your Spirit on the first disciples, that they became the very beginning of the church, and that movement spread all around the world, filling people with your love, including us today. Help us to still be filled with your Spirit and still ready to share your love. Help us to be the church today, a church that will always have birthdays and go on and will never die, for you are always alive in the hearts of your people. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thanks, everybody. It's actually your birthday today? All right. Happy birthday to you, too. All right. So you have your actual birthday today? Excellent. Happy birthday. All right, everybody. We're going to head back to Children's Church, go back to Sunday school. Younger kids, you're done singing from Fusion. You can go back, too. If you're one of the younger kids, you go back to Sunday school, too. Friends, it is that time in our service when we share our joys and concerns with one another as the kids are heading out. I did get a text message this morning from Dave Tenney that his mom is not doing well. She was moved into ICU in St. Joe's, so I'll try to run out there later this afternoon, but please keep Mrs. Tenney in your prayers. If there are others today, I invite you to please raise a hand, joys or concerns, and an usher will bring a microphone to you.
I'm asking prayers for my cousin's great-granddaughter. Her name is Jade. She's 3 years old. She's been diagnosed with cancer around Christmas time, and she's had a major surgery and been on chemo all this time. Her expected end of treatment test and scans unexpectedly showed a new nodule on her lungs. Many prayers are needed, and she's 3 years old.
So please keep Jane in your prayers, who is 3 years old. Keep her in your prayers and the whole family.
Good morning. I have a joy and a praise. Last week it was my daughter-in-law. She'd gone to the Cleveland Clinic, and the doctor said there has been no advancement in the pre.
Amen. So please continue to keep members of Stanley's family in your prayers. Are there others this morning? In the back on this side? Okay. So please keep Amy in your prayers as she recovers. And if you did not hear TJ, his wife Kayla, our youth sports ministry leader, has an autoimmune problem that she battles. Frequently, she has flare-ups, and she's having one of those right now, having difficulty seeing and with her one of her eyes and some overall health issues. So please keep Kayla in your prayers right now as well. Are there others this morning? Yes. Is there a second microphone? Right up in the front here to Lanny in the, right, there you go.
Thank you. My daughter Heidi the other day got up and thought she had a bladder infection. And she went to Mercy Health and they said, we're going to send you.
So I apologize, I'm not sure what's happening with the microphone this morning, but Lanny's daughter Heidi had to have her appendix removed. So please keep Heidi in your prayers as she recovers also. Yes, I'm sorry. I'm not sure if it's working, Larry. I could have Elizabeth with hers.
Just wanted to request prayers for a friend of ours, Pat Ford. He's having his remaining kidney removed tomorrow due to cancer.
So please keep Pat in your prayers as well. Just a second, Bob. She's coming around to you. Bob Buckland is in town and able to be here to worship with us this morning, and he's going to share something also.
I'd like to bring something up. My daughter here, my oldest, trying to help me back into getting it dislocated, come back to my church. Unfortunately, her church burned last week. And we're both hurting on that. So please think about it and give them your nurse. And thank you all.
Bob, I'm so sorry. Your daughter's here with you, and your church burned down, is that I heard you say, last week?
Yeah.
Okay. So So please remember the people in that church family also. All right, friends, if there are no others, I invite you to join together in our prayer song this morning as we prepare our hearts for prayer this morning. It's one that talks about God filling us with his Holy Spirit on this Pentecost Sunday. It's called Spirit Song. Friends, would you please join with me for a moment of silent prayer as we come to our God together in prayer today. Lord God, on this Pentecost Sunday so long ago, you came and filled your lambs. You came to those first disciples, and they were scared, for Christ had died and left this world. But they received the power of the Holy Spirit, and they were set on fire, and you were alive in their hearts. And they went forth boldly and lived. It happens in the beginning of Acts, and the whole rest of the book of Acts is about the acts, the actions they take to help people, to preach to people, to teach people, to love people, to do so in bold ways, and the way that they lived changed the world and spread your Spirit and love, and the church was born. Lord God, we just pray this morning that your Holy Spirit would fall again afresh, anew on us, just like it did those disciples so long ago. May we remember on this Pentecost Sunday, 2,000 years later, that your Holy Spirit is still alive and is still alive in us, and that you long to fill us with your Spirit so much that it overflows from us, that it causes us to live boldly with our lives, filled with loving actions for the world to see. And so, Lord, let's pray that that would take place with our lives, with the way that we live and love. May we show the world that you are still alive. We may be the church, the body of Christ, still alive in this world so that people can see that you are real, Lord, and your love is real because it's in us. And we put that love into action. May we do so boldly, Lord, at Pentecost and always. Lord God, we pray for people that we've mentioned this morning, and we give you thanks that we can lift them up to you. So we pray for Mrs. Tenney this morning in ICU, that you'd be with the doctors and nurses and those caring for her. Let your healing hand be upon her. Pray for Jane. Pray for Sandy's family, for Kayla, for Amy, for Heidi, for Pat, for this church family that just had their church have this fire, for all those on our prayer request list, Lord, and for others whom we name before you silently in our hearts. Lord, whether people need the touch of your healing hand or the strength and comfort of your Holy Spirit, we just pray that they would be with you, would be with each person in a strong and mighty way, that they would feel your presence, that you'd pour out your Spirit on this Pentecost Sunday on them, your healing power, your comfort, Lord, of that Spirit, if with anyone who needs it. And Lord, again, wherever it's possible, use us to be the body of Christ, to be someone's answer to prayer, to give someone hope that the kids just sang about. So Lord, fill us, fill your lambs this morning with that Holy Spirit, and let us carry out into this world that needs your love and Spirit so much. We pray these things together this morning in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, our Lord Jesus said that where your treasure is, there your God. Friends, our Lord Jesus said that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. I promise it's in the Bible. That's what he actually said. We worship God at this time, the offering of our hearts and treasures. Friends, would you pray with me, please? Lord God, we just thank you for this opportunity we have to come here today to worship you, to give back in gratitude for all you've blessed us with, Lord. At Pentecost, as you pour out your Holy Spirit on us, we give back to you, Lord, in gratitude for what you've given us. Take what we've given, Lord, this morning and use it somehow to spread your love, to touch people with your love through what we give. In the name of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen. Friends, you may be seated. As you've heard me say several times now, today is Pentecost Sunday. There used to be a tradition that people would wear red on Pentecost Sunday. And Elizabeth is looking at me as if I'm skipping something, so let me see what I am skipping. I am skipping a Pentecost hymn, so forget what I was about to say. And I'll change it to this instead. So the story of Pentecost, what happens is the people receive, we'll see this in a minute when we read the book of Acts, they receive the Spirit, and so the breath blows upon them, a mighty wind blows on them, God's Spirit comes into them. And so Elizabeth's going to lead us in singing, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. Because of the children this morning, we're sharing music stands and everything this morning. So we're singing, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. But understand, when you're singing that, you're singing, Breathe on Me, Breath of God, fill me with life anew, just like you did those disciples 2,000 years ago at Pentecost. When you sing these words, that's what you're singing about. This hymn is Breathe on Me, Breath of God. And so that is our prayer, the words of that hymn on this Pentecost Sunday, that God's breath would breathe on us, His Spirit would breathe His life back into us. And we're going to look at a scripture where that happened, the birthday of the church. It's Pentecost. Look at Acts chapter 2 together, just the first few verses where it actually happens. And so we have the disciples gathered together on this day of Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed like to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And then from that time, they go forth the rest of the book of Acts, and they go out and spread God's love and God's Spirit, and they change the world. That's the birthday of the church. That's Pentecost. That's what we celebrate today. Friends, would you please take a moment to pray with me and for me? O Lord, by the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Friends, all around the country and even around the world, there are places where the church is really in decline. There are places where it's growing also. But in our country, for example, the church is in decline. Fewer and fewer people from each generation that follows, each younger generation, end up going to church or raising their kids kind of thing in faith. And so as that kind of dwindles, we see a number of churches around that are down just a handful of people, and they're struggling. And I'm sent in often to try to help one of these churches try to rediscover their mission again or rediscover their purpose again. And sometimes they'll say, we're still alive, but we feel like we're mostly dead. And so I'm going to show you a scene from one of my favorite movies this morning. It's one of my family's favorite movies. It's a comedy called The Princess Bride. If you've ever seen The Princess Bride, then you know what I'm talking about. If you have never seen The Princess Bride, you're going to think it's a really strange movie, because this is a kind of comedy, and it's kind of different. It has very quotable lines in it and everything if you've watched it. But in this scene, there is a magician whose name is Miracle Max. And a friend is brought to him. These people bring a friend to him because he's dead. And they want to bring him back to life, and they want a miracle from Miracle Max. And he ends up making a chocolate pill for them in the end to bring him back to life. But the idea is that he's dead, and they need a miracle. And it turns out the magician says to him, he's not dead, he's mostly dead. And mostly dead is slightly alive. And if you are slightly alive and have something worth living for, then you can come back to life again, and they receive the miracle. So here's that scene from The Princess Bride.
Sir?
Huh?
We're in a terrible rush.
Don't rush me, sonny. You rush a miracle, man, you get rotten miracles. You got money?
65.
Sheesh. I never worked for so little, except once, and that was a very noble cause.
This is noble, sir. His wife is crippled. Children are on the brink of starvation.
Are you a rotten liar?
I need him to help avenge my father, murdered these 20 years.
Your first story was better. Where's that bellows cram? He probably owes you money, huh? Well, I'll ask him.
He's dead. He can't talk.
Look who knows so much, huh? Well, it just so happens that your friend here is only mostly dead. There's a big difference between mostly dead and all dead. Please open his mouth. Now, mostly dead, he's slightly alive. Now, all dead, well, with all dead, there's usually only one thing that you can do.
What's that?
Go through his clothes and look for loose change. Hey! Hello in there! Hey, what's so important? What you got here that's worth living for?
Love. You heard him? You could not ask for a more noble cause than that.
Yeah, sonny, true love is the greatest thing in the world. Except for a nice MLT, mutton, lettuce, and tomato sandwich when the mutton is nice and lean and the tomatoes ripe. They're so perky. I love that. But that's not what he said. He distinctly said to blave. And as we all know, to blave means to bluff. Huh? So you're probably playing cards and he cheated.
Liar!
Back, witch!
I'm not a witch, I'm your wife! But after what you just said, I'm not even sure I want to be that anymore!
You never had it so good.
True love. He said true love, Max.
Don't say another word, Valerie!
He's afraid. Ever since Prince Humperdinck fired him, his confidence is shattered.
Why'd you say that name? You promised me that you would never say that name.
What? Humperdinck? Humperdinck! Love lies expiring, and you don't have the decency to say why you won't help.
Nobody's hearing nothing.
Humperdinck! Humperdinck!
This is Buttercup's true love. If you heal him, he will stop Humperdinck's wedding.
Shut up! Wait, wait. I make him bear the Humperdinck suffers?
Humiliations galore.
I did a lick, Baldanisha. That is a noble cause. Give me the 65. I'm on the job.
That's a miracle pill.
The chocolate coating makes it go down easier, but you have to wait 15 minutes for full potency. And you shouldn't go in swimming after for at least, what?
An hour.
Yeah, an hour.
A good hour. Yeah.
Thank you for everything.
Okay.
Bye-bye, boys.
Have fun storming the castle.
Think it'll work?
It would take a miracle.
Bye-bye.
At the end, they said, do you think it'll work? And he says it would take a miracle. The chocolate coating helps it go down faster, and he shouldn't go swimming at least for an hour after he takes it. You couldn't hear some of that stuff. It's a comedy. It's a funny comedy if you've never seen it. But the point of this is, why I'm showing the scene this morning, is because so many times churches say, basically, we're mostly dead. And I know that's not our church, but I'm saying this happens a lot out there. And churches that are mostly dead are still slightly alive, I always say, like this says. And if you have something to live for, then you can come back to life again, okay? I say this in marriages as well. I don't always quote the Princess Bride, but sometimes when couples are struggling, I say, we feel like things are mostly dead between us, but is it still slightly alive, and is it worth saving? Because if so, you know, that's something you can still build upon. You can have life come back into your marriage again, or anything in your life works this way, right? Because God's Spirit can do any miracle. God's Spirit can revive marriages, can revive churches, can revive this country, right? We often talk about how we need a revival. Do you know how revival happens? It happens when enough people open up their hearts to God's Spirit that God can pour out His Holy Spirit on His people again, just like He did at Pentecost with that kind of power. There are still millions of Christians all over the world. And if all God's people everywhere would open up their hearts to God's Spirit at Pentecost and always, we were really filled to overflowing with God's Holy Spirit, we absolutely could change this world. We absolutely could. I'll show you one other scripture. This comes from Ezekiel chapter 37, long before Pentecost when the church was formed. It's a scripture where Ezekiel has this dream about this field of dead bones, and the idea is that God can bring anything back to life with His Spirit. Look at these verses from Ezekiel chapter 37. The hand of the Lord was upon me, this is Ezekiel speaking, and He brought me out by the Spirit. And the Lord set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then He said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. And this word is breath, ruach, spirit. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked and tendons and flesh appeared on them and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then He said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain that they may live. So I prophesied as He commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then He said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says, O my people. I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord, where I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. This is a period in Israel's history long before Pentecost and Jesus, when they were lost, and they had no hope, and they had no life. But God said He could pour out His Spirit on them then, just like God always can, and bring them back to life. It's the same word in Ezekiel, the spirit, breath, ruach, is the same word that we see at Pentecost. It's actually the same word in Genesis. You've heard me say this before. In the very beginning of the Bible, when God breathed His Spirit, His breath, His ruach into Adam, and Adam comes to life. Since the beginning of creation, God has been breathing His Spirit, His breath, His ruach into us. And we are filled with that Spirit. And on Pentecost, the disciples were filled with an outpouring of that Spirit, and they went out and changed the world. And Pentecost today means still remembering that we're just like them, that if we open our hearts, God can fill us with His Spirit. It doesn't matter how old we are, how young we are. What matters is that we have open hearts. And if our hearts are open to that Spirit, God longs to put His breath, His ruach, His Spirit in us and send us out to change the world. I want to show you one other movie clip this morning from another of my movies that I enjoy. This one's called Sister Act, so maybe more of you have seen this one. But I'm not going to show you Whoopi Goldberg singing or the choir singing anything this morning, but instead I'm going to show you a scene from this movie where they get church right. So a lot of movies that have to deal with churches or pastors, I'm always intrigued, of course, to see those. I'm kind of a movie buff. A lot of times they put churches in a really negative light, or pastors or priests in a really negative light, not really depicting what they're trying to be in this world. Ironically, a comedy, Sister Act, gets it right. And in this scene, the nuns are basically, they're just working there, and they never go out into the world and engage the world and spread love, and they get the chance to. And they go out and they spread God's love and interact with people, and they find that people reach back to them and start coming back into the church as they live out the mission of the church to spread love. So here's a little scene from Sister Act also.
So you can fade it out for me, granted, thank you. So you see the idea is though is that when they started going out in the world and trying to spread love and not just being filled with the Spirit but carrying out into the world, that they reached people and people started coming and responding to that and coming back to the church. That's what the mission of the church is supposed to be. Ironically, a movie, a comedy like Sister Act actually kind of lives that out, kind of shows what the church is supposed to be. A long time ago, people received the Holy Spirit and they went out and spread God's love, and it caught like wildfire and changed the world. The world was never the same. We are still just as capable today of being filled with God's Holy Spirit. And we come here to worship to be filled with God's Holy Spirit. So when you're here, it's okay to be joyful, right? It's okay to laugh. It's okay to clap your hands, to raise your hands if the Spirit leads you to do whatever, to say amen, right? Sometimes you like to hear somebody say amen, and you hear like crickets, right, kind of thing at church. Right? It's okay to be alive with God's Holy Spirit. Sometimes it's fun to go to a sporting event, because at sporting events, people are yelling and cheering. Yeah, they're really in it for their team, right? I'm not saying that church needs to be that, right? But it should be a place where we are alive with God's Spirit, with joy, with the wonder of what God has done for us, with gratefulness for what God has done for us. And we carry that joy and gratefulness and love out into the world and put it into action. If you're relatively new to our church, and still we remind you this once in a while, we use three words here to explain that. It's in your bulletin all the time. We invite, we inspire,
we involve. Invite people to come to check out what's going on here. And there's so many things from worship to vacation Bible school to all the things that happen here. Invite people to come and check something out. Then we inspire, and inspire comes from what we're talking about today, spirit in, inspire, to put God's spirit into people, to have them open up their hearts to God's Holy Spirit so they're filled with that spirit. And then involve. We involve people in what God is doing here. All the incredible ministries that happen in this place, get them involved and going out into the world and helping in all the things that happen in this place in God's name. So we come here, we invite them here, we inspire them, we fill them with God's spirit, and then we involve them. We send them out into the world. Invite, inspire, involve. It's our mission. It's what we try to do. Bring people here. Fill them with God's spirit. Send them out to serve. It's what we want all of you to do with your lives, to understand it's what our mission is. There are many churches struggling in a lot of places. It happens because we lose sight of that mission. We need to come here and be filled with that spirit and then carry it out into the world so that people will be involved in what's happening here in God's name. Today, it's Pentecost. It's the birthday of the church. So happy birthday, church. Today is the day that God poured out his Holy Spirit on the people and the church was born. But God is still alive and his Holy Spirit is still alive. What's happening is that not enough people anymore are opening up their hearts to that Holy Spirit and being filled with that Spirit and then carrying it out to change the world. God wants to have all of us open up our hearts. Imagine what would happen if all Christians around the world, this is what pastors pray for every Pentecost, right? That God's people would open up their hearts anew, not just in our church, but every church, everywhere, be filled with God's Spirit, be inspired, filled with God's Spirit, and then be involved in spreading that Spirit around the world. Imagine what would happen to this world if the millions of God's people everywhere did that with their hearts and with their lives. That's how the world will one day change. And I'm an optimist, I know, but I believe the world is going to change. I know things are rough right now with the wars and everything going on and the prejudice that exists and hunger and everything exists in this world, but the world can be changed. I believe in the miracle that God can bring about because God has done it so many times. But that miracle happens when we open up our hearts. So may that be our prayer at Pentecost and always. Let the church say amen. All right, friends, we're going to join together in our closing song together today. As From the Ground, it comes forward and leads us in a song that reminds us that God wants to build his kingdom here and set the church on fire and set it across the whole world with his Holy Spirit. I invite you to please stand if you're able as they lead us in singing, Build Your Kingdom Here. As they're getting ready, next Sunday is Memorial Day Sunday. Janelle and I are going to be on vacation next Sunday. I proposed to my wife in the sanctuary of the church where I grew up and told her she was the answer to my prayers. I have done very little romantic ever since then. So I'm taking her on a vacation this week. Gabby's going to preach next Sunday. Larry Beardsley and others will tell you that there is a Darren that can preach better than I, several, in fact, and Gabby will preach next Sunday. If you want to wear something patriotic next Sunday, we'll be honoring our veterans next Sunday as Gabby leads us in that worship. For this morning, though, we're going to end this time together by singing Build Your Kingdom Here. Power in us. Friends, amen. Let that be our prayer always, Pentecost Sunday especially, to be filled with that Holy Spirit and to carry it out into the world that God may build his kingdom right here on this earth. We pray your kingdom come, but we need to build it here on earth with the way that we live and love as we're filled with God's Spirit. As you leave this place and do so with your lives, may the blessings of God the Father Almighty, Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord and Savior, and the peace and unity and fire of the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you always. Amen.